we could have the band just like start playing and live and everything and just jump right into it. But normally, there's when you're learning what an artist is about, you have what's called pre-production meetings. And you get with the band and you're hanging out with them, you hear the songs, generally just an acoustic guitar and a vocal, you know. I mean, you kind of learn what the songs are about, and where it's coming from in a more primitive state before everything's already arranged and thrown in there. And so I thought we should begin by doing that, and then we're going to like approach the sort of technical aspect of miking the drums and move on from there.
When Frank came in, brought his drums in here, he had them set up for playing live, and first thing I said, and this is about the only thing that we've done, to be honest, in preparation with these guys, is that the tom sounded pretty dead. Maybe you could hit one of your toms that you've got back there.
It is hard.
I asked him to put some different heads on the toms. And
yeah.
Here they got more zing to them, they're brighter. It's one of those things that the instrument is the first place you go. Mm-hmm. It's you know, you can put any microphone you like on that drum and it's going to always be a dead drum.
Can we hear the kick drum?
We can hear the kick drum. Before, this is the other thing we changed, is that he had really well padded up inside. I mean, there was big old pillow in there, and it was really short sounding. And I said, well, I wonder if we could find something else to, and Rich found something to stick in there. And
what did you stick in there?
The towel. Very, very lightly against the capacitor.
So it's a bit more opened up. We've got a drum that's got like sympathetic vibrations going on, the whole thing's ringing, and sounds musical to me.
The other thing about this method is that we can get more cymbals by going forward. More air, more drums by pulling back. The most dramatic I've seen this done is the Glenn Johns mic technique, or Bill Schnee, which spreads these out kind of like that, and then your third mic. This is a classic four mic drum miking technique. This, a snare mic that's back off to pick up the hat and a kick. There's your basic classic Led Zeppelin rock and roll drums. It's pretty big, but the modern use of this is you pull these in. Have a little tighter top on the stereo. Let's start like this. And done right, this should pick up the tenor tom just fine.
So
let's get the gain back first so we can do half this time.
You know, I mean, what we could do is try miking off center of the cone there, or we could try maybe, if we want to get some of that horn, we could try coming in, you know, maybe coming in here or something, but I would imagine that horn's fairly, I would imagine that's pretty high up there, and I don't really care about that out of a bass amp. So, there we go, we're going to try that. The thing to remember when you're miking like the top and bottom of a snare drum, or if you decide to mic the top and bottom of the toms, is that the front head is going to be moving this direction, the bottom head is going to be moving this direction. So one is taking pressure up away, while the other one is putting a positive pressure on something that's being mic'd down there. So you actually have an opposite polarity. It's probably not exactly 180 degrees, but mostly that's all we have available as a quick fix on a console when you have more than one microphone. You need to deal with phase issues. So if you're miking the top and bottom of something, put the put the secondary element, which would be the bottom mic, out of phase.
There are so many different ways to do this. You know, the garage sound where we back well off, and so you have kind of a vague kick sound because it's 6 feet away, maybe. If that fits in the music, there's nothing wrong with that. Nothing that says that you have to do it any given way, as long as it feels right